Ladies and gentlemen, dear guests, I warmly welcome you to the Jewish Museum Berlin. My name is Hafsa El-Buhamushi. I'm a research associate at the Jewish Islamic Forum, and I will lead you through this evening's lecture. Let me begin with this building. By creating a building that consists of different elements and materials, the architect Daniel Liebeskind left several interspaces on purpose. They allow views into the in and outside of the building and stand for the vast Jewish tradition which is transmitted and brought to the public through the Academy's work. Since 2013, our work focuses on exploring these interspaces, and we are discussing the space minorities, and especially the Jewish and Muslim minorities in Germany, are given. With the forum, the Academy of the Jewish Museum Berlin aims to illuminate the relation between Judaism and Islam and to create a platform for the examination of philosophical and practical questions of religion. One consistent part of the Jewish Islamic Forum is the dialogical lecture series, where we discuss such questions as those about human rights that touch on criticism of religion, change of religion, gender equality in Holy Scripture, and today's topic, the right to life in Judaism and Islam. At this juncture, I would like to thank the Allianz Kulturstiftung for kindly supporting this lecture series. So this evening's lecture is dedicated to one of, or maybe even the most important human right, the right to life. Now, we all would agree about the fact that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a bit younger than the Holy Scriptures of the Torah and the Quran. Thus, the value of the human life and the right to live occurs in both texts and is deeply anchored in both. Obviously, we have to differentiate between legal rulings regarding states and the norms and rulings we find in the scriptures of Judaism and Islam. What we understand from the legal tradition of both religions are naturally texts that need interpretation, appropriate understanding, and a form of implementation that depends on the cultural and timely circumstances of the respective context. According to that, we should dare to shift perspectives this evening and try not to be scared by the mere word Sharia. Furthermore, we have the opportunity to shed light into a vast tradition that deals since centuries with questions of the right to life and physical integrity in the context of legal punishment or martyrdom. Both traditions value the right to life at highest esteem. Therefore, we find almost the same verse in the Quran and the Mishnah regarding this, the implication of killing a human being, where it says corresponding, "Whoever kills a person, it is as though he has killed all mankind." Both traditions value human life as almost sacred, since human beings have been created in the image of God and are only not to be harmed, but this passage goes further by stating that the saving of one human being means to save the entire humanity. Please note in both texts. Considering the right in Judaism and Islam that states the right to life and the right to stay physically unharmed on the one side, on the other side, we have to take into account legal rulings that allow corporal punishments, mutilation, called head punishments in Islamic law, and capital punishments for capital crimes, such as murder. So the question that arises here is, if the right to life is constrained by those forms of punishment, or if it is rather preserved in terms of protection of legal rights. This is a current debate, since capital punishment is still practiced in 58 countries, this based on the assumption that is the only just retaliation for capital crimes. Being a right so controversial, what is the argument laid down in the Holy Scriptures? Is it the same rationale that lies behind the death penalty in some states of the US and in Muslim-majority countries such as Saudi Arabia or Iran? So you already must have recognized that this evening's lecture is not about the fields of bioethics and related questions of when life actually begins, or what both scholars would say regarding euthanasia, but we will deal with the question if the right to life is violated through a legislation that allows corporal punishments right up to the death penalty. And I'm more than delighted to welcome our distinguished two speakers who are capable of unraveling the branches when it comes to the questions of balancing the right to life against the legal grounds of capital punishment in the Jewish and Islamic tradition. We will have a lecture by both our speakers, and afterwards you will have the chance to ask questions. Before I introduce our first speaker, let me point out that we provide headphones so you can listen to a German translation of the lecture. But for Professor David Novak's lecture, this won't be even necessary since he's holding his lecture in German, which is quite remarkable as he was born and raised in Chicago. Professor Novak holds the J. Richard and Dorothy Schiff Chair of Jewish Studies as Professor of the Study of Religion and Professor of Philosophy at the University of Toronto since 1997. Prior to that, he taught at numerous universities and also served as a pulpit rabbi in several communities in the US. Professor Novak published a vast number of books and articles dealing with Jewish philosophy, philosophy of religion, and Jewish political theory. And I will just name a few here. His most recent contribution in this field was published in Natural Law, a Jewish, Christian, and Islamic Trilogue. The book discusses the classical writings of the respective tradition and explores how natural law doctrine functions in particular traditions for reflection upon the religious other. In Covenantal Rights, a Study in Jewish Political Theory, which was named the best book in constructive religious thought by the American Academy of Religion in 2000, he attempts to bring insights from the Jewish political tradition into current political and legal debates about rights and to bring legal discourse more fully into Jewish thought. Professor David Novak is a founder, vice president, and coordinator of the Jewish Law Panel of the Union for Traditional Judaism and a founder and faculty member of the Institute of Traditional Judaism in Teaneck, New Jersey. And he's the author of Dabru Emet, an important document with the title Speak the Truth, concerning the relationship between Christianity and Judaism, and signed by over 220 rabbis and intellectuals from all branches of Judaism. A statement that did stress on the importance of a common ground of faith and was adopted by numerous interfaith initiatives. So, welcome with me Professor David Novak with the title Das Recht auf Leben als Grundrecht in der jüdischen Tradition.
Danke. Meine Damen und Herren, von Recht auf Leben zu sprechen, bedeutet ganz genau davon zu sprechen, was man ein Recht nennt. Als Rechtinhaber habe ich einen gerechtfertigten Anspruch darauf, dass Sie mir nichts antun oder aber dass Sie etwas für mich tun. Im Mindesten besteht dieser gerechtfertigte Anspruch darin, in meinem Recht von Ihnen nicht von dem abgehalten zu werden, was ich tun will. Das heißt, dasjenige, was ich will, kann als gerechtfertigter Anspruch an Sie ausgedrückt werden. Ihre Pflicht ist es also, mich nicht davon abzuhalten, was ich vernünftigerweise tun will. Ihre Pflicht ist es, mir beizustehen. Außerdem wird ein Anspruch dann zu einem Recht, wenn er gemäß des in der Gemeinschaft des der Rechtsinhaber in der verpflichteten geltenden Gesetzes gerechtfertigt werden kann. Auf diese Weise gebietet mir das Gesetz, auf gerechtfertigte Ansprüche zu antworten. Es gebietet mir, gehorsam auszuüben, sowohl gegenüber Ihrem gerechtfertigten Anspruch an mich als auch gegenüber meinem gerechtfertigten Anspruch an Sie. Ein Recht ist dann ein Grundrecht, wenn ein gerechtfertigter Anspruch eine Pflicht enthält, welche gleichzeitig ein negatives Gebot, du sollst nicht tun, und ein positives Gebot, du sollst tun, umfasst. Der Grund, weshalb das Gesetz eine ihm entsprechende Pflicht vorschreibt, ist die Erfüllung eben dieses Rechts. In der jüdischen Tradition ist das Recht auf Leben ein solches Grundrecht. In diesem Fall verbietet das Gesetz, den Rechtsinhaber zu töten. Für diejenigen, welche die eine Rechtfertigung trotzdem tun, sieht das Gesetz eine Bestrafung vor. Darüber hinaus verpflichtet das Gesetz alle, dem Rechtsinhaber dabei zu helfen, am Leben zu bleiben. Wenn allerdings kein Grund für eine Verpflichtung besteht, kann sie nur dadurch gerechtfertigt werden, dass sie der willkürliche Befehl eines launischen Tyrannen ist. In einer Gesellschaft, in welcher gesetzliche Verpflichtungen nicht gerechtfertigt sind, das heißt, in einer Gesellschaft, in welcher keine Gründe für die Verpflichtungen bestehen, hat niemand irgendein Recht. In einer solchen Gesellschaft kann sich niemand vor der Verfügungen der politischen Machthaber schützen. Es existiert keine Grundlage, auf welcher gegen die Verletzung eines Rechts protestiert werden kann, weil in einer solchen Gesellschaft niemand außer politischen Machthabern irgendein Recht hat. Das Recht auf Leben und die ihm entsprechende Pflicht finden sich in der Tora in 4 ausdrücklichen Geboten. Erstens, habe ich ein gerechtfertigtes Recht zu leben, wenn ich einen Anspruch darauf habe, dass sie mein Recht auf Leben nicht verletzen. Das ist mein Recht, am Leben zu bleiben. Die Bibel drückt ihre Verpflichtung als negatives Gebot wie folgt aus: Du sollst nicht morden. Zweitens, habe ich einen Anspruch darauf, dass sie mir zu überleben helfen, das heißt, mich von tödlicher Gefahr retten. Das Bibel drückt diese Verpflichtung als positives Gebot wie folgt aus: Du sollst nicht stillstehen bei dem Blut deines Nächsten. Drittens, habe ich einen Anspruch darauf, dass sie mir dabei helfen, mein Leben physisch zu erhalten. Die Bibel drückt ihre Verpflichtung als positives Gebot wie folgt aus: Wenn dein Bruder herabsinkt und seine Hand wankt neben dir, du sollst ihn festhalten, erlebe er neben dir. Viertens, habe ich einen Anspruch darauf, emotional und spirituell von ihnen genährt zu werden. Die Bibel drückt ihre Pflicht in diesen Worten aus: Du sollst deinen Nächsten lieben wie dich selbst. Es muss allerdings hinterfragt werden, ob Sprache ein Konzept des modernen Rechts auf den normativen Diskurs in jüdischen Traditionen angewendet werden können. Tatsächlich gilt es, dass die jüdische Tradition nur von Pflichten, Chovot auf Hebräisch, spricht und nicht von Rechten. Für die Liberalen bedeutet die Autonomie, dass ich willkürlich und straflos entscheiden kann, ob ich mein Recht ausübe oder nicht, solange die Ausübung meines Rechts sie nicht daran hindert, ihr Recht auszuüben. Zwar erkennt die jüdische Tradition eine Form von Autonomie, was mein Eigentumsrecht angeht. Die jüdische Tradition erkennt jedoch keine solche Autonomie im Falle meines Körpers an. Weil mein Körper genauso wenig mein Eigentum ist wie ihr und genauso wenig ihr Körper ihr Eigentum ist. Um es mit den Worten der Bibel auszudrücken, Gott sagt: Wohlan, alle Seelen, mein sind sie. Leben wird zur Pflicht, sogar wenn ich mein Recht auf Leben ausüben will. Aber weil jede Pflicht eine Antwort auf das Recht von jemand anders ist, muss meine Pflicht zu leben eine Antwort auf den gerechtfertigten Anspruch von jemand anderem an mich sein. Philosophisch gesprochen bedeutet diese Pflicht nicht Autonomie, sondern Heteronomie, nämlich das Gebot eines anderen. Luther in den Worten des französisch-jüdischen Philosophen Immanuel Levinas: Wer sind diese anderen? In einer Welt, welche von Gott geschaffen wurde und welche von Gott regiert wird, ist der einzige absolute Rechtinhaber schlüssendlich Gott, unser Schöpfer. Nur die Rechte Gott sind ursprünglich. Die Rechte aller Geschöpfe sind Anrechte Gottes. Deshalb verpflichtet mich das Vorrecht, Gott zu leben, selbst wenn ich versucht bin, mein Recht auf Leben nicht auszuüben. Als Gottes Schöpfung kann ich selbst nicht auf ein Recht verzichten, welches mir nicht gehört. Was für mich gilt, gilt auch für jedem anderen nach dem Ebenbilde Gottes erschaffenen Menschen. Niemand kann straflos töten oder getötet werden. Gottes höhere, transzendente Autonomie überwältigt niedere, immanent menschliche Autonomie. Das ist der Grund, weshalb das erste Gebot, du sollst nicht morden, welches ich vorher zitiert habe, wie alle Gebote im Dekalog mit den Worten eingeführt wird, ich bin der Herr, euer Gott. Das ist auch der Grund, weshalb das zweite Gebot, du sollst nicht stillstehen bei dem Blut deines Nächsten, mit den Worten, ich bin Gott, schließt. Und das ist auch der Grund, weshalb der dritte Gebot, du sollst ihn festhalten, so lebe er neben dir, direkt gefolgt werden von den Worten, ich bin euer Gott. Und schließlich ist dies der Grund, weshalb der vierte Gebot, du sollst deinen Nächsten lieben wie dich selbst, mit diesen Worten schließt, ich bin Gott. Unsere Rechte sind also nicht absolut, sondern sie durch Gottes Recht bedingt. Wenn wir unsere Rechte aus Anrechte Gottes ausüben, müssen andere ihnen gehorsam leisten. Darüber hinaus halten wir Gottes Recht für gerechtfertigt, weil die Gebote, in welchen sie ausgedrückt werden, schlüssig und kohärent sind, und weil wir davon ausgehen, dass es die Absicht dieser Gebote ist, Menschen zu verbessern. In jüdischer Tradition betrifft diese Argumentation Tamei HaMitzvot oder die Gründe der Gebote. Alle Gebote sind uns unverzüglich gehorsam zu leisten, dass sie sind dasjenige, was Gott uns gebietet zu tun. In vielen Fällen verfügen wir Menschen über eine beachtliche Entscheidungsfreiheit darüber, wie dem Gebot gehorsam geleistet wird. Wir können also darüber nachdenken, weshalb Gott uns eine bestimmte Handlung anstelle einer anderen auszuüben gebot. Wir können daraus schlussfolgern, selbstverständlich mir nur verläufig, dass diese Gebote aufgrund der Rechte, welche Gott allen Menschen erteilt hat, aufgestellt werden. Die Erfüllung dieser Rechte ist der Grund oder Zweck der Gebote. Schlussendlich erscheinen die oben erwähnten Rechte auf Leben und die ihnen entsprechenden Pflichten moralisch einfühlsamen Personen einigermaßen selbstverständlich. In diesem Sinn können wir als universell oder natürlich bezeichnet werden. Die Rechtfertigung eines Rechtes hängt am Ende vom metaphysischen Status der Person des Rechthabers ab, gemäß der Tradition der Gemeinschaft, in welcher diese Person ihren Rechtsanspruch stellt. Wie eine Person in dieser Gemeinschaft von anderen behandelt wird, wird größtenteils davon bestimmt, als wer diese Person gilt. Selbst wenn die oben erwähnten positiven und negativen Gebote als universell oder natürlich verstanden werden, das heißt als verbindlich für alle Menschen, so erlauben bestimmte Traditionen, dass die Gebote ausschließlich auch positive Gebote dargestellt werden, um sie in der realen Welt dieser Gemeinschaft zu proklamieren und geltend zu machen. Die Grundregeln der jüdischen Tradition wurzeln alle in der Bibel, in dem, was die Christen das Alte Testament nennen. Die Ausarbeitung und Weiterentwicklung dieser Grundregeln finden allerdings in der rabbinischen Literatur statt, welche sich Talmud nennt. Im Talmud wird dasjenige, was wir heute das Recht auf Leben nennen, ausführlich verhandelt. Nun sind diese Abhandlungen so zahlreich und detailliert, dass es unmöglich ist, sie in einem oder sogar in mehreren Verträgen zusammenzufassen. Lass sie an der Ansatz der richtigen Rabbinen der Antike, Rabbi Akiva ben Yosef aus dem 2. Jahrhundert, genauer anschauen. Die normative jüdische Tradition folgt ihm in beinahe jeder wichtigen Angelegenheit aufgrund seiner starken Persönlichkeit und der Kohärenz einer Leben. Ein älterer Kollege rief einst gegenüber Rabbi Akiva aus: Akiva, wer von sich trennt, trennt sich vom Leben. Der große deutsch-jüdische Philosoph Hermann Cohn, welcher in 1918 hier in Berlin verstarb und auf dem Friedhof Weißensee begraben ist, sprach von einer Theorie der Praxis. Rabbi Akivas Theorie der Praxis, Deutsch für Tamei Mitzvot, ist die überzeugendste im Vergleich zu anderen Talmud-Rabbinen. In Bezug auf das Recht auf Leben, so kommt Rabbi Akiva Theorie der Praxis auf den folgenden Abschnitt der Jerusalemer Talmud hervor. Zitat: Du sollst deinen Nächsten lieben wie dich selbst. Rabbi Akiva sagt, das ist das größte Prinzip in der Tora. Ben Asai sagt, dies ist der Urkunde der Zeugungen der Menschenschlechts. Am Tag, da Gott das Menschenschlecht erschuf, machte dies in Gottes Gleichnis. Dieses ist ein größeres Prinzip. Endzitat. Nun schlägt Rabbi Akiva vor, dass Nächstenleben das umfassende Gebot in der Tora ist, weil es alle untergeordneten Gebote in sich enthält. Es ist das höchste zwischenmenschliche Gebot. Tatsächlich enthält es die Gebote menschliches Leben nicht zu töten, sondern es zu retten, zu erhalten und ganzheitlich zu nähren. Nächstenliebe ist jedoch ein Gebot. Es ist kein Prinzip. Das ist, was Ben Asai meint, nämlich, dass ein umfassendes Gebot einen umfassenden Grund mit einschließt, für welchen das Gebot geboten wurde. Deshalb bestreitet Ben Asai Rabbi Akivas Bezeichnung des Gebotes des Nächstenlieben in das höchste umfassende Gebot nicht. Im Gegenteil, Ben Asai unterlegt Rabbi Akivas ethische Beurteilung mit einer tieferen theologischen Grundlage. Die Gottesbildlichkeit des Menschen schlecht ist das Prinzip oder die Grundlage, wie im Lateinisch Principium, das Gebotes der Nächstenliebe. Die Gottesbildlichkeit des Menschen schlecht rechtfertigt das höchste Gebot der Nächstenliebe. Er ist der ultimative Grund, Ultima Ratio auf Latein, des Gebotes der Nächstenliebe. Was Gott gebietet, hängt zusammen mit der Frage, was der Mensch ist, was wiederum die Antwort auf die Frage ist, wie Gott den Menschen erschaffen hat. Der Vers über die Erschaffung des Menschengeschlechts im Gleichnis Gottes erklärt auch, warum Gott gebot, unserem Nachbarn zu leben. Alle Menschen sind als Gleichnis Gottes geschaffen. Deshalb verdienen alle Menschen, geliebt zu werden, denn Gott liebt mit Sicherheit diejenigen, welche im eigenen Ebenbild geschaffen wurden. Deshalb sind wir verpflichtet, nicht nur Gott zu lieben, sondern auch diejenigen, welche Gott liebt und welche in der Nachahmung Gottes handelt, Imitatio Dei auf Latein. Menschliche Ähnlichkeit zu Gott ist das Prinzip, welches Nächstenliebe zur Norm für das Zusammenleben der geliebten Abbilder Gottes in der Welt macht. Diese Sichtweise Gottes offenbart sich in der Erzählung über die Erschaffung der Menschenschlechts ist in der Tora. Ben Asais Antwort auf Rabbi Akiva zeigt, dass menschliche Rechte auf Leben ein Anrecht Gottes sind. Auf diese Weise hat jeder Mensch das Recht, nicht umgebracht zu werden, das Recht, von tödlicher Gefahr gerettet zu werden, das Recht, physisch am Leben zu bleiben und das Recht, emotional und spirituell genährt zu werden. Das ist, was Gott allen Menschen gab, indem er uns in Ebenbild oder in Gleichnis Gottes schuf. Diese Gabe Gottes wird zu unserer elementaren Aufgabe in der Welt. Dieses Anrecht wird zu unserem Recht auf Leben, wenn wir diesen ausüben wollen. Dieses Anrecht wird zu unserer Pflicht zu leben, wenn wir diese ausüben müssen. Es scheint, als hätte Rabbi Akiva Ben Asais Vertiefung seines Spruchs über den grundlegenden Vorrang von Nächstenlieben akzeptiert. Letztlich weist Rabbi Akiva Ben Asais Standpunkt nicht zurück. Er bestreitet ihn nicht. Folglich könnte Rabbi Akivas Zulassung von dem Asais Erklärung oder Rechtfertigung in folgenden Spruch erkannt werden. Zitat: Geliebt, Chaviv auf Hebräisch, ist der Mensch, der er wurde im Ebenbilde, Bezelem auf Hebräisch, erschaffen mit besonderer Liebe. Es wurde ihm offenbart, dass ihm im Ebenbilde erschaffen, so heißt es, denn ihm im Ebenbilde Gottes hat er den Menschen gemacht. Endzitat. Man könnte sagen, dass das Ebenbild oder das Gleichnis Gottes die menschliche Verbindung zum Gott ist, was ermöglicht wird durch Gottes Beziehung zu uns. Gott liebt uns und wir können seine Liebe erwidern. Das Ebenbild Gottes bezeichnet die Beziehung zwischen Gott und dem Menschengeschlecht. Die Rechte und Pflichten, welche diese Beziehung enthält, sind der Stoff, aus welchem die Wechselbeziehung gemacht ist, welche die Bibel Bund nennt, Brit auf Hebräisch, und welche im Gesetz des Bundes, das heißt in der Tora, festgeschrieben wurde. Das Ebenbild oder das Gleichnis Gottes bezeichnet nicht dasjenige, was Gott ist und was wir Menschen sind, sondern diese Beschreibung der Menschennatur bezeichnet auch das, was Gott tut. Was Gott tut, indem er jedem Menschen erschafft, ist, dass er diesen Menschen zum Objekt der Liebe Gottes macht. Als Objekt der Gottes Liebe hat jeder Mensch das Recht, von allen anderen Menschen zu verlangen, dass sie Gott nachahmen, indem sie diesen Menschen lieben. Weil Gottes Liebe nicht unser Eigentum ist, dürfen wir sie nicht horten oder unseren Mitmenschen verwehren. Als Objekte des höchsten Gebots der Nächstenliebe ist es unsere Pflicht, jedem anderen Menschen so liebevoll wie möglich zu behandeln. Manchmal bedeutet dies so wenig, wie jemand anderem nicht umzubringen. Manchmal bedeutet sie, jemand anderen zu retten. Manchmal bedeuten sie, jemand anderen am Leben zu erhalten. Und manchmal, am allerhöchsten, bedeutet sie, jemand anderen zu nähren. Es scheint so, als würde Rabbi Akiva deinen Nächsten zu lieben wie dich selbst bedeuten, dass wir zunächst uns selbst lieben sollen und anschließend diese Selbstliebe am anderen erweitern. Mit anderen Worten, du sollst lieben deinen Nächsten, wie du liebst dich selbst. Darüber hinaus ist die Selbstliebe nicht Ottoman, weil sie auf der ursprünglichen Tatsache beruht, dass Gott uns Menschen liebt. Zuerst liebt Gott also mich, dann liebe ich mich selbst und dann wird mir geboten, sie zu lieben. Wenn ich du sollst nicht morden als minimale Nächstenliebe verstehe, kann ich mich dann dem trotzdem entscheiden, am Leben zu bleiben, wenn diese Entscheidung wahrscheinlich zu ihrem Tod führt? Das ist die Frage, welche in diesem berühmten Disput in Talmud stellt. Zitat: Über den Fall, wenn zwei Personen sich auf dem Weg befinden und im Besitze des einen sich ein Krug Wasser befindet, wenn beide daraus trinken würden, würden beide sterben. Aber nur einer könnte er eine bewohnte Gegend erreichenden und überleben. Wenn Petrus druckt vor, lieber beide trinken und sterben, als der einen den Tod des anderen sehen. Was aber kam Rabbi Akiva und lehrte, es lebe dein Bruder mit dir. Dein eigenes Leben geht dem Leben deines Nächsten vor. Endzitat. Die Beziehung von Petrus bedeutet, dass ich nicht mal eine indirekte Ursache, was in Talmud Gramma heißt, für den Tod meines Nächsten sein darf, auch wenn diese Entscheidung meinen eigenen Tod bedeuten kann. Meine Nächsten und ich sind gleich, sowohl im Leben als auch im Tod. Ist Rabbi Akivas Standpunkt hier dem nicht entgegensetzt ein Beispiel für egoistische Selbstlieben? Also, ist dies nicht eine Ich ist zuerst Handlung? Nimm mein Besitz nicht Vorrang von demjenigen eines anderen, weil mein Körper mir gehört? Nein. In Sinn Rabbi Akivas liebe ich mich selbst, weil Gott mich liebt und weil alle anderen Menschen Gott auch liebt. Wenn wir Menschen wählen müssen, wen wir zuerst lieben, so sollen wir denjenigen lieben, welche uns am nächsten sind. Selbstverständlich muss die furchtbare Wahl nicht getroffen werden, wenn mehr als ein Leben gerettet werden kann. Aber wenn nur ein Leben gerettet werden kann, soll dasjenige Leben gerettet werden, welches mir am nächsten ist, sogar wenn diese Entscheidung direkt den Tod meines Nächsten verursacht. In diesem Fall bin ich selbst dasjenige Leben, welches mir am nächsten ist und welches deshalb gerettet werden soll. Andererseits, wenn ich mein eigenes Leben dadurch retten kann, dass ich jemand anderen direkt töte, wenn mir befohlen wurde, jenen zu töten, sonst töte ich dich, dann habe ich kein Recht, mich selbst auf Kosten dieses Opfers zu retten. Das ist sogar dann so, wenn diesejenige Person, welche mir befiehlt, diese andere Person zu töten, diese Person ohnehin selbst töten würde. Rabbi Akivas Standpunkt geht aus der Erzählung einer geheimen Gesetzen von Rabbinen in das Jahr 135 hervor. Rabbi Akiva war der führende Teilnehmer dieser Sitzung. Die geheime Sitzung wurde von den Rabbinen einberufen, über die Antwort auf die Anordnung des römischen Kaisers Hadrian zu beraten, welche die öffentliche Praktizieren des Judentums verbot. Diese Anordnung wurde wahrscheinlich deshalb erlassen, weil die römischen Herrscher über das Land Israel fürchteten, dass für die Lehre der Tiere und Praxis der Tora notwendigen öffentlichen Zusammenkünfte tatsächliche revolutionäre Versammlungen seien. Auch brachten die Römer Juden über Todesdrohung dazu, öffentlich die Gebote der Tora zu verletzen. Zitat: Im Solle des Hauses Nizza in Lod stimmten sie ab und beschlossen das, was man jemand bei Todesandrohung zwingt, eine alle in der Tora genannten Sünden zu begrehen, das soll er sie begrehen und nicht töten lassen. Ausgenommen sind Götzendienst, Unzucht und Mord. Endzitat. Tatsächlich erwähnt der Talmud in dieser Erzählung über die Entscheidung der Rabbiner auch, was ein späterer Rabbi angesichts ein tätliches solchen Falls vorschrieb. In diesem Fall wurde der Fragesteller mit dem furchtbaren Wahl von einem öffentlichen Beamten konfrontiert, welcher die Entscheidungsmacht über Leben und Tod sowohl des Fragestellers als auch des Opfers hatte. Der Fragesteller erhielt diese Antwort vom Rabbi: Mag ich dich töten, du aber begehen keinen Morden. Mit einem solchen Fall wird dem Leben des nächsten Opfers Vorrang vor dem Leben des nächsten Angreifers gegeben. Mord ist Notwehr, als Notwehr ist in der Tat nur dann erlaubt, wenn ich das gesehene Opfer diesen direkten Dröhnen bin. In Rabbi Akivas Perspektive soll nicht nur das Töten alleine, sondern auch ein von Gesetz legitimiertes Töten vermieden werden. Demfolge wird Rabbi Akiva zusammen mit seinem älteren Kollegen Rabbi Tarfon wie folgt zitiert: Wenn wir im Sanhedrin säßen, würde nie ein Mensch hingerichtet worden sein. Noch wieder. Wenn wir im Sanhedrin säßen, würde nie ein Mensch hingerichtet worden sein. Endzitat. Was hatte diese kühne Behauptung zu bedeuten? Zunächst stand die Todesstrafe zu demjenigen Zeitpunkt, von welchem Rabbi Akiva diese Aussage traf, im 2. Jahrhundert, außer Frage. 100 Jahre vorher ermächtigten sie die Römer dazu, wen immer sie wollten im Land Israel zu exekutieren. Aber als Aussage eines vernehmten Vertreters, selbstvernannten Messias Shimon Bar Yochai, war Rabbi Akivas Behauptung nicht ausschließlich hypothetischer Natur. Er arbeitete auf die erhoffte messianische Befreiung der Juden von der Gewaltsherrschaft der Römer hin. Er hoffte, dass Bar Kochba den jüdischen Menschen absolute Souveränität zurückbringen würde. Obwohl Rabbi Akiva ohne Zweifel die vollständige Rechtkehr jüdischen Strafrecht erwartete, so sah er nicht vor, je am Töten menschlichen Leben teilzunehmen. Er hatte wohl alles in seiner Macht Stehende getan, um diese grauenvolle Verantwortung zu vermeiden, obwohl die nachteiligen traditionellen jüdischen Kriterien vorstreckte Todesstrafe sich erheblich von der Häufigkeit und Grausamkeit der römischen unterscheiden würde. Zweitens, Rabbi Akiva aus theologischen Gründen die Gebote der Tora zu Hinrichten verschiedener rechtmäßig verurteilter Kriminelle nicht direkt aufheben. Niemand darf das Gesetz Gottes aufheben. Trotzdem geht der Talmud davon aus, dass diese Aufhebung de facto erreicht werden kann, indem er die rechtlichen Bestimmungen, die Beweisführung so streng hält, dass es praktisch unmöglich wäre, jemanden zu so einem Streif zu verurteilen, aus schlichter Tötung, aus Notwehr, wie gebilligt. Aus schlichter ist es, Rabbi Akiva, das Pflicht zu leben, keine absolute Pflicht. Wenn er der Martyriertod zu seiner einzigen Vertreter-Alternative ist, das ist es eine Pflicht zu sterben. Die Pflicht, eher Martyrien zu sterben, als eine andere Person anzubringen, stellt für alle Juden einen kategorischen Imperativ dar. Aber Rabbi Akiva ging weiter, als die Römer die öffentliche Praxierung der Gebote sowie die öffentliche Lehren der Tora verboten, lehrte Rabbi Akiva anhand seines eigenen Beispiels, dass ein Rabbi sich einem sicheren Tod aussetzen muss, wenn er der Wahl begegnet, entweder Juden die Tora öffentlich zu lehren oder aber ihre Gebot privat zu praktizieren. Diese von Rabbi Akivas vorschlagene Entscheidung wurde in derselben Sitzung beschlossen, in welcher aus die Entscheidung bezüglich des Martyriums getroffen wird. Der Talmud berichtet, Zitat, es wurde der Frage aufgeworfen, ob das Studium oder der Tat bedeutender ist, sei. Dann begann Rabbi Akiva und sprach, das Studium ist bedeutender. Hierauf stimmten alle, so dass Studium bedeutender sei, dass das Studium bringt zur Tat. In Zitat. Als Rabbi Akiva vor der Entscheidung stand, zu praktizieren, was er selbst lehrte oder nicht, wählte er bewusst das Martyrium. Was die anderen Juden betraf, so wählte das Martyrium sie, deshalb schien für ein einfacher es zu vermieden, indem sie so privat als möglich verblieben. Rabbi Akiva erklärte diese Wahl als seine Weise, sich aus der Gebote des Gottes Liebe zu halten, welche den Juden gebietet, Gott mit deiner ganzen Seele zu leben, nämlich sogar, wenn er, das ist Gott, deine Seele nimmt. Endzitat. Selbstverständlich tötete Gott Rabbi Akiva nicht direkt. Die Römer folterten ihn zu Tode. Sein Einhalten des Gebots Gottes war nicht die direkte Ursache für seinen Tod, aber es war der direkte Grund für seine Bereitschaft zum öffentlichen Martyrium anstelle von privater Sicherheit. Jüdische Menschen haben während des Holocaust gelernt, dass physisches Überleben kein Zweck an sich selbst ist. Auf diese Weise wurden Juden immer privater, immer unsichtbar. Indem Rabbi Akiva öffentlich die Tora lehrte, sogar als diese zu seinem furchtbaren Tod führte, gab er dem religiösen und kulturellen Überleben der jüdischen Menschen, deren eigentlicher Grund von Überleben von der gottgegebenen Tora stammt. Vorrang vor seinem eigenen individuellen Überleben. Letztlich haben alle Juden, welche sich dazu entscheiden, öffentlich als Juden zu leben und welche die Tora akzeptieren, Rabbi Akivas Entscheidung getroffen, sogar wenn wir nicht mit einer Situation konfrontiert werden, in welcher wir diese Entscheidung direkt zu treffen haben. Trotzdem, als jüdische Juden öffentlich in der Welt zu leben, das ist vielmals gefährlich. Es ist niemals kostenlos, sondern es ist immer sehr gut und es ist immer sehr wertvoll. Das ewige Leben, Chai Olam auf Hebräisch, welche wir Juden von der Tora her aus unserem Anerkennen kommt vor dem individuellen Überleben. Aber Rabbi Akivas Entscheidung war nicht passiv, denn er hat gleichzeitig aktiv an der Kochsbers Aufstand teilgenommen. Auf diese Weise kämpfte er für physisches und politisches Überleben, auch wenn diese immer das Mittel zum Zweck aller Zwecke sind. Wie es ein Kollege Rabbi Akiva metaphysisch formuliert, wenn nicht die Tora, würden Himmel und Erde nicht bestehen. Und sage ich, wenn nicht die Tora, würden das jüdische Volk nicht überleben, weil ohne Tora wir zwecklos in der Welt würden. Vielen Dank.
Thank you very much, Professor Novak, for your excellent talk that pointed out the essential duty of preserving life and for leading us through this act of counterbalancing the value of one's own life against the life of another person, also in terms of martyrdom and Jewish theology. Let us continue this conversation by introducing Professor Jonathan Brown. He is the Al-Walid bin Talal Chair of Islamic Civilization in the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University, and he's the director of the Al-Walid bin Talal Center for Muslim-Christian Understanding. Professor Brown has studied and conducted research in several countries such as Egypt, Syria, Yemen, South Africa, India, Indonesia, and Iran. He has published several books and articles in the fields of Hadith, Islamic law, Salafism, Sufism, Arabic lexical theory, and pre-Islamic poetry. And he is the editor-in-chief of the Oxford Encyclopedia of Islam and Law. His most recent book, Misquoting Muhammad, The Challenges and Choices of Interpreting the Prophet's Legacy, was named one of the top books on religion in 2014 by The Independent. He lays out how Muslim intellectuals have sought to balance reason and revelation by taking a historical journey through key and controversial aspects of Islam. In the canonization of Bukhari and Muslim, the formation and function of the Sunni Hadith canon, he charts the origins, development, and functions of these two texts through the lens of canonicity, and he examines how the books went from controversial to indispensable. In Stoning and Handcutting, Hudud and the Sharia in Islam, he outlines very comprehensively how corporal punishments have to be understood by taking into account the vast legacy of Islamic law and its scholars. Professor Brown, the floor is yours.
Hello. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you. I'm Muslim, just to make that clear, in case any of you didn't know that. So I'm not just some random white guy up here speaking on behalf of Muslims. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a big honor to be here. It's wonderful to come to Germany because I love the bread. And it's great to speak on a panel, and it's a big honor to speak on the panel with Professor Novak, whose books I was just reading totally independently of this event. Then I realized it was the same person. I was very happy. Okay. So I was asked to talk about corporal punishment / capital punishment and torture. These are really, you know, kind of unpleasant topics, so I don't want you to think I just sit around and think about all this stuff all the time. They asked me to talk about this. I'm going to do my best. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Okay, first of all, I don't like engaging in cheerleading. You know what cheerleading is? Like rah-rah cheerleading. But, you know, saying things like Muslims invented ice cream or something like that. But, as far as I know, Muslims invented human rights. Because in the late 700s and the early 800s, Muslim jurists developed the concept of what's called huquq al-ibad, which literally means the rights of the slaves of God, which are human beings, or huquq al-adamiyya, or the rights of Adamic people, i.e. human beings. So the rights of human beings. Here, of course, we should understand rights as both things that you have a right to, but also the flip side of a right being duty. So there's certain duties we're talking about here, as well as the idea of rights as protected interests. So when we talk about huquq al-ibad in the Islamic tradition, the rights, human rights, the rights that all human beings have, we're both talking about rights in the sense of the English word, but also duties, as well as notions of certain protected interests, things that God's law or God desires to protect for human beings. These are especially true, the rights of the slaves of God, the rights of human beings in Islam, are thought of as the rights that human beings have vis-a-vis each other, rights that they have over one another, and protected interests they have with regard to one another. The rights of the slaves of God, human rights, are in contrast to another concept that early Muslim scholars developed, namely huquq Allah, or the rights of God. So the rights of mankind, and then there's the rights of God. The rights of God can be two different types of things. The first is what we might think about as public rights, or kind of public law, obligations to society. For example, an obligation not to murder, or an obligation not to threaten public order. and also the idea that God wants to protect public order. The second type of thing that the rights of God can be are certain offenses, certain sins that are particularly grievous and offensive to God. So there's certain things that people can do that are so offensive to God that this is a violation of the rights of God. These include not only things like worshiping things other than God, but in the context of what we're speaking about tonight, we're really talking about certain crimes, certain sins that are specified in the Quran and in the precedent of the Prophet Muhammad, and that are seen as particularly grievous in the eyes of God, and also, interestingly, often private sins. It's a type of crime that is private, you could probably get away with. And these are known as what's called in Arabic the hudud, and we'll talk about those later. The hudud means the boundaries of God. We'll discuss these later, inshallah. Okay, so first I want to make clear that these are invented categories. The Quran doesn't say, verily, these are the rights of human beings, and these are the rights of God. These are categories that Muslim scholars invented beginning in the late 700s and the early 800s, so the sort of the end of the first century of Islamic history. And they developed these concepts in the centuries that followed. What that means is that they're not airtight categories. They're sort of conceptual categories that Muslim scholars came up with, but they sometimes things don't fit perfectly. They blend into one another. And Muslim scholars readily admitted this. So they admitted that these are categories they came up with in an attempt to understand, looking at the Quran, looking at the precedent of the Prophet Muhammad, looking at the legacy of the early Muslim community, and trying, looking at all these different particulars to abstract from them, to derive from them certain rights. Okay. I'm going to talk about kind of two generations of development when Muslim scholars were trying to abstract these human rights. The first generation starts happening in the late 700s and the early 800s of the Common Era. And Muslim scholars abstract, derive out three different rights, human rights, rights that all human beings have, regardless if you're Muslim or not. First, the right to, it's called nefs. Nefs is life. But what they mean by that is the right to physical inviolability. So I can't just go up and kill you, for example, or go up and hit you on the head with a hammer. You have a right to physical inviolability. The second one is the right to mal. Mal is property. So people have the right to property. And the third thing, they have the right to deen. They have the right to religion. Everybody has a right to their own religion. So people, Muslims allow other people to practice their own religion, even under Muslim rule. And just a good example of how these are considered universal rights, maybe you've heard of sati. Sati in kind of Hindu family of religions is a upper class Hindu woman throwing herself on the funeral pyre of her dead husband. So self-immolation. Now, the British outlawed this in 1829. For many centuries of Muslim rule in India, Muslim rulers allowed sati. They allowed it, provided the widow received permission from the Muslim governor so that he could be sure she wasn't being forced to do it. If she wanted to do it of her own will, the Muslims allowed them to do this. Even though suicide is prohibited in Islam, it's prohibited, they said this is their religious right, and as long as they're not violating someone else's right to life, i.e. she's not being forced to do this, she has the right to do it. Okay. Now, by the time we get to the 1000s of the Common Era, so roughly, 400 years after the beginning of Islam, Muslim scholars have developed, added more rights, like a sort of second generation of human rights, to the right to physical inviolability, the right to property, the right to religion. They've added the right to what's called nesl. Nesl is like family or lineage. It's also the right to chastity. What does this mean? You have the right to not have your paternity impugned upon. So a man has the right to be the father of his children. If The right to physical inviolability means you prohibit murder. The right to property means you prohibit theft. The right to lineage means you prohibit adultery. You prohibit sex outside of legitimate, licit relationships. They also added the right to reason, aql, the right to reason. So Muslims can't intoxicate themselves. You cannot deprive yourself or others of your right to reason. And they added also what's called ird. Ird in Arabic means honor or dignity. Human beings have a right to honor or dignity. Now, those first three rights we talked about, physical inviolability, property, religion, these are unquestionably universal in the Islamic tradition. But when you start talking about other things like reason and dignity, it starts getting a little bit less universal, right? So Muslims allowed non-Muslims, let's say Christians living under Muslim rule, they allowed Christians to drink alcohol. So if you were a Christian, you could make beer, like say you're German, okay? You could make beer, drink beer, and you could get drunk, and as long as you didn't go in the street and make trouble, this was your right because that's your religious right. So they don't force this right on non-Muslims. Dignity or honor, this is you know, controversial, because non-Muslims have less right to dignity than Muslims under Muslim rule. So for example, if I go to another Muslim man and I say, you son of a bitch, okay, then I have slandered that person. But a Muslim cannot slander a non-Muslim living under Muslim rule. So there's like a hierarchy that gets created where non-Muslims have less right to dignity than Muslims. Okay. These rights, now, so that I've laid out the rights. These rights can be lost or removed for a cause. For a cause, right? So just like in America, I have the right to be free unless I commit a crime and then they put me in prison, right? So these things can be lost or removed for a cause. You can lose your right to property if you injure somebody and have to compensate them for that injury. Or if you're given a fine and you have to pay the fine, you have to lose some of your property. A Muslim can lose their right to dignity if they commit certain crimes. For example, false testimony. If I testify in court and I lie, this is called Arabic shahid zaur. If I do this, there was a certain punishment where people would be put on a donkey and like tarred and feathered, you know, and then they'd walk around town with a person on a donkey. So you get really humiliated. Or they cut your beard off if you're a man or something. It's really humiliating. So you can do certain things that will cause you to lose dignity. And of course, what we're going to talk about tonight is you can lose the right to bodily integrity, to physical inviolability, if you commit certain crimes. Okay, so your right to physical integrity, bodily inviolability, can be lost due to two different kinds of crimes. The first one is a violation of the haq adami, the human right of another person. So, Hafsa, I'm gonna use you as my example because I've already victimized this poor guy, right? Let's go, I have to go Hafsa, and I take this thing of water and I bash it over her head. I'm not gonna do this. So I have injured her and now I have to compensate for that injury. This is financial. But let's say I go and I kill somebody. I take away their life intentionally. I intentionally murder them. The Quran and the precedent of the Prophet gives three options. First, the family of that person can ask that I be killed. So I can lose my right to life because I've committed this crime. But the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad also encouraged the second option, which is payment of what's called dia or the blood money. So I would pay that person's family money to compensate for that person's death. The third option is that the family could actually just forgive me altogether and say, you know, no big deal. I mean, it is a big deal, but you don't have to, we're not going to execute you, for example, or take your money. What normally happened in Islamic civilization, the majority practice was the payment of the diya, the payment of the blood money. By the way, to such an extent that, for example, when the British took over India in the 1700s and they started having to run the Sharia courts under their control, they were very, they really found this very odd. You know, when Muslims, when murders happened, people would just pay money, and they thought this was really kind of, people were bribing one another. They didn't realize this was actually a way to reduce further damage in society. Okay. The second way that you could lose your right to life or physical inviolability was if you violated one of the rights of God, one of the rights of God. And these, as I mentioned before, are something called hudud. You've probably heard about this if you, like, you know, watch right-wing American television or anything like that, Fox News. They always talk about hudud, and you talk about stoning and lashing and things like this. So these are the, hudud mean the limits, the boundaries. These are the boundaries of God. And these, again, this is not a category that the Quran sets out. The Quran doesn't say, here are the hudud crimes. These are understood by Muslim scholars in the first two centuries of Islam, looking at the Quran, the precedent of the Prophet Muhammad. And these are particularly crimes where the Quran or the Prophet Muhammad has set out a specific punishment. Everybody following me? Okay, there's some guy in back there nodded. That's great. Excellent. I'm going to tell you the five hudud crimes. And there's a little bit of disagreement. Are there five or six? But I'm going to give you five main ones. The first one is, oh, and by the way, you'll notice there's also an overlap here on some of them between the rights of God and the rights of human beings. So some of them are both violations of God's rights and violations of the rights of other human beings. Okay, the first one is zina. Zina is sex outside of legitimate relationships. It's like both fornication and adultery. Sex outside of marriage, essentially. Okay. The punishment, there's two punishments for this. If you're married and you do this, you get stoned to death. If you're not married and you do it, you get 100 lashes. Now, to be clear, and this goes for the rest of the evening. When I say lashes, this isn't like, you know, 12 years a slave, Michael Fassbender. Isn't he half German or something? Yeah. I mean, obviously, it's not his fault. He's just an actor, right? But, you know, when he, like, this isn't like the things you see in the movies where, like, the big bullwhip. This is more like, you know, a riding crop, like a riding whip you hit horses with? Like, it's like a stick. So this is what the lashes are. It's like a stick like that. So the punishment is 100 lashes. Now, this is important. Based on the Quran itself, you can't carry out these punishments for zina, for adultery, unless you have four witnesses who, and I'm sorry to do this, but this is the language of the Prophet himself. He said, you have to see like the eyeliner thing is going into the bottle of the eyeliner. Like, you know, mascara? Arab men wore mascara. That's pretty cool. So you have to see like this. And if you don't have four people who see this, if you go up and accuse somebody of adultery without having four witnesses or three others besides you, you get lashed 80 times for slander. Why is this? Why do you have a very serious punishment and then almost impossibly high standard of evidence? The reason is this is actually pretty common in pre-modern law systems, pre-modern criminal law. If you don't really have police force and you don't really have a government and police cars and telephones and lots of paper and police dogs and all this stuff, states don't really have the capacity to engage in policing. The government doesn't have a lot of law enforcement capacity. So you have to scare the heck out of people. You have to scare people into not committing crimes using very serious punishments. But of course, you don't want to actually have to carry these punishments out, so you have very high standard of evidence. Okay. The second crime, that was adultery. The second one is intoxication. If you consume an intoxicant as a Muslim, if you're not Muslim, consume all the intoxicants you want. Just don't go and like cause a car accident or a donkey camel accident, right? If you do this, the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, the precedent of the Prophet Muhammad, is you get 80 lashes. The third offense is premeditated, deceptive, concealed theft. Arabic, it's called sariqa. It's a very specific kind of theft. The punishment is getting your hand chopped off. Just like adultery, the standard of evidence is extremely high. The Prophet Muhammad made it clear that the thing you have to steal has to be over a certain amount of money, and it has to be in a protected location, and it can't be like a type of food or something like that, and it can't be something you think is yours. What this meant, by the way, is in Islamic courts, in Islamic civilization, if you stole something, in order to avoid getting your hand cut off, all you have to do is say, I thought it was mine. And then you don't get your hand cut off. Doesn't mean you get off scot-free. You still get punished. We'll talk about that later. Okay. The fourth had crime, the fourth of the hudud crimes, is qadhif. Qadhif in Arabic means sexual slander. If you say someone, you committed this adultery, you did this sexual thing, your mother's a whore, things like this. This would be qadhif. The Quranic punishment is 80 lashes. And the last one, hudud crime number 5, is hiraba. Hiraba means banditry. Kind of a weird, banditry. But it's a concept that comes along with it in the Quran is ifsad fil ard. That means causing corruption in the land. Causing corruption in the land. And this was very closely associated with rebellion and also with open violation or subversion of the public order. So this was stuff like today we would think about really violent crime. You know, like in American movies, you know, like going with an M16, things like this. Really violent crime, which is a big threat to public order. But it also slipped into notions of political destabilization. And this crime had the most serious punishment as specified in the Quran. The Quran mentions this, that you get crucified or you have your hands and your hand and your foot chopped off. But that's actually, that punishment is very rarely used because this crime, banditry, sowing corruption in the land, is understood to be at the discretion of the political authority. So most of the time, if a political authority like a sultan or a caliph or an Ottoman sultan, for example, was going to punish someone for this crime, they would just execute them. Okay. Now, I said earlier, remember, let's say somebody gets caught naked with someone else's wife, but there's only 3 people who see, you know what, right? That's not 4 people, that's not enough. It doesn't mean they get to say, ah, ha, 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 we got away with it. This is terrific, right? No, no, no. There's another kind of punishment called ta'zir. Ta'zir is discretionary punishment. So if I went and stole Hafsa's extremely expensive iPhone, I don't know if you have an iPhone or not, but let's say I steal this, and I get caught on videotape stealing this, what do I say to avoid having my hand cut off? Anybody? I thought it was my phone. My bad. That doesn't mean I'm still either going to have to give this back to her, I'm going to have to compensate her for it, and I'm also going to have ta'zir punishment. Ta'zir punishment means any punishment essentially up to the limit of the hudud punishment. So if it's 100 lashes for adultery, then maybe you get 99 lashes. It's up to the hiraba, the banditry crime, is the political authority's discretion. Ta'zir is up to the judge's discretion. The legal authority, not the political authority. It's up to the judge's discretion. The type of punishments in Islamic civilization that were used most often were, again, lashing, putting someone in prison, but prison was not nearly as common as in the modern period in the US and Europe. By the way, it's very important to remember this. For most of human history, prison is not the way human beings punish one another, punish offenders. Prison is extremely expensive to feed people. And they're still alive. They could escape and cause problems. It's a lot easier to just whack them really hard, right? Cause pain. It's cheap and quick. Okay. Where was I? Oh, yes. Types of, okay, this, another type of punishment, exiling someone. Another type was, and this is not very common, fining them. Fining people financially is relatively uncommon in Islamic civilization. And especially something that happened later on when you get into the 18th and 19th century, especially in the Ottoman Empire, is hard labor. Doing hard labor. By the way, exactly the time that using hard labor was starting to become common in Europe and Britain. Okay. Having covered that, how much time do I have?
Still enough.
Still enough. Excellent. Now we get to torture. Torture is a very, it's a tough word. So I think torture is not the word that is appropriate in Islamic civilization. Because at least in English, when you say torture, you think, you know, being put in the Iron Maiden, being put on the rack, you know, you get like in Braveheart. Who saw Braveheart? Only two people in the whole audience? You should all go see Braveheart. It's a very good movie. That, you know, getting really nasty stuff. This is not what we're talking about, torture in Islamic civilization. There is torture in Islamic civilization, but it's like stuff that nasty caliphs or sultans did. You know, let's say my vizier is trying to have me assassinated and take over, then I do something horrible to him. But these are people who are all awful, right? I mean, this is not religiously sanctioned. This is like, you know, I don't know, Donald Trump's not that bad, but it's like bad political stuff. In the case of Islamic law, I prefer to use the term intentional infliction of pain. Intentional infliction of pain. Because the methods we're talking about are essentially that beating with the whip. That's the, when they talk about torture in Islamic law, they're talking about hitting someone with a lash, with that stick. Especially, by the way, something that became very popular in the Ottoman Empire was what's called bastinado in Spanish. So bastinado is you take someone's feet and you hit it with like a reed. You hit the bottom of their feet with the reed. And you can say, that's not that bad. So one time when I was with my mother, we were cleaning out the closet and we found this like long reed. My mom said, "This looks like a bastinado reed." And I said, "That's not that bad. That's nothing." And she said, "Okay, try it." She lay down on the bed and she went whack and she hit my foot once. I said, "Ah, it's horrible. It's very painful." She's died a while ago, so she can't get arrested or anything. Okay. All right, what were they talking about? Okay, yes. It's very important in Islamic law, intentional infliction of pain as part of the judicial process is closely linked to detention or prison. The two are really often discussed together. Okay. And here we have to remember there can be different types of imprisonment, and this overlaps a lot with infliction of pain. You can have what's called custodial detention. So that would be, let's say, someone's in trial. They're detained in the prison during the trial, just to keep them from leaving. Then there's what's called coercive detention. This is where I put someone in prison in order to make them do something. And here you can start seeing where there's an overlap with torture. I want to get information from you, so I'm causing you pain, or I'm detaining you. And third, there's penal detention. This is like putting someone in prison. You know, you get convicted of a crime, you go to prison for 30 years. That's the third kind of prison or detention. So we have to keep that in mind. There's different types. This is very important because Muslim scholars distinguish between these different types. All Muslim scholars agreed that custodial detention was allowed. In fact, this was the main use Both in Islamic civilization and in any civilization, in any society, prior to the modern period, the main use of prisons or jails was to detain people during the course of a trial, during the legal process. And there's very good evidence that the Prophet Muhammad himself did this, which is the basis for Muslim scholars doing it. There could be a coercive element here, but it was in order to find, so the good example here is someone who owes money. So let's say I come and say, Hafsa, sorry, you're my example again. Hafsa says, Jonathan Brown owes me $100,000. And I say, I don't have any money, I'm broke. I'm a professor, right? And so they say, the judge says, put him in prison for a few days. After a couple days, okay, you know what? I might have some money lying around. I could probably find for you. So that's one way. But there's a very strict limit on how long you can be kept in prison for this. Maximum 3 months. Maximum 3 months. Okay. All Muslim scholars agreed that you could do coercive beating after the verdict. After the verdict. So, Hafsa has accused me of destroying her iPhone. I have been shown to be guilty, but I refuse to pay up. Then you get whacked in order to, you get your feet beaten or whatever, or lashed so that you pay up. You can force someone to fulfill their obligation as has been legally determined by the legal process. All right. And all Muslim scholars agreed on the permissibility of penal detention. So they agreed that prison was an acceptable punishment for a crime. But again, this wasn't very common in Islamic civilization because prison was not very common anywhere in the pre-modern world. Where Muslim scholars disagreed, where there was great disagreement amongst Muslim scholars, Muslim jurists, is on the use of coercive beating to assess guilt. So the use of coercive beating in order to make someone confess. This was very, very disagreed on. And it was disagreed on because it was extremely problematic. It was extremely problematic for two reasons. The first is that it violated one of the accused person's rights. Remember, a person has the right to physical inviolability unless they've committed a crime. So if you haven't proven they've committed a crime, or they haven't proven that they've done something that should cause them to lose this right to physical inviolability, you can't take a stick and start hitting them on the bottom of their feet. The second problem is more specific. The Quran says that if you are coerced into denying your religion, this doesn't count. So if somebody comes up to me and puts a gun to my head and they say, curse God, say you're not a Muslim anymore. I'd say, I'm not a Muslim anymore. No big deal. And the Quran says, this doesn't count. This is not a problem. Obviously, you're under coercion. So if the Quran says that statements made under physical duress, under coercion, are not valid, how the heck is statements made under getting, you know, beaten or tortured, how are those going to be valid in a court of law? This is pretty common sense, right? Muslim scholars had three different opinions on this, on whether you could use coercive beating during the legal process. The first opinion, and this is especially common in the Hanafi school of law early on in Islamic civilization, they said this is not allowed, for exactly the reasons I just told you. The second school of thought said judges can't do this, but the political authority can. So you could have like executive branch can do this. Just like in the US government, the executive branch can talk about state secrets and national security and things like that. It's like the executive branch has special authority. The third position was that everybody could do this. I mean, both judges and political authorities could do this, and it wasn't that big a deal. The question is, How do they explain, or how do they solve these two problems I told you about? How do they solve these two objections, the violation of someone's rights and the fact that, according to the Quran, coerced evidence is not valid? Coerced statements aren't valid. There were a couple of different arguments they used. Some of them not so good. Some of them okay. The first argument was, the proof is in the pudding. Do you have this saying in German? Probably not. The proof is like, you know, if I say, I make great cake, I'm a wonderful chef, my wife can say, you talk a lot, the proof is in the cake. Where's the cake? Let me see, right? So what these scholars would say is, yes, we beat the person and we got information out of them, but the information was correct. So if I'm accused of stealing Hafsa's iPhone and I get beaten on the bottom of my feet and I say, okay, okay, it's in my hotel room on the top shelf, behind, you know, the blanket, and the police go there and they find, ah, there's the iPhone, sure enough. What these scholars say is, the guilt is established by the fact we found the stolen item. The second solution was to say, yes, coerced statements are not accepted, but not all pain is coercive, right? So, you know, let's say you don't hit someone too hard and you hit them only a few times and you're mostly scaring them, that doesn't count as physical coercion, torture, as we're discussing. A lot of Muslim scholars objected to this. They said, that's not a very good argument. First of all, how do you know how much pain it takes somebody to make them break or say something that's not true? You know, we can't really say this for any group of people with any consistency. The third solution was to say, yes, yes, we smacked the bottom of his feet many times, and he said something. He said he's guilty. He said he stole the iPhone. But then we stopped smacking him, and we let him go back to his room for a bit, and he still says he stole the iPhone. He still admits it. He admitted it even after the torture had stopped. This is also not a very good argument. And a lot of Muslim scholars pointed that out. They said, you think that the person doesn't, you know, maybe they might think that you're going to torture them again, right? So they're still under apprehension that pain is going to be caused. The final argument, and I'm going to end with this point because it brings the whole discussion full circle. The final argument they used is that, and this becomes especially common, interestingly enough, in the 1300s of the Common Era, all the way up until the early modern period. This is the argument that Muslim scholars used to justify physical coercion or infliction of pain during the legal process. They said, we need to do this because otherwise we are unable to get justice, right? Someone steals something and we don't have enough ways to find out if they're guilty or not. There's no witnesses, there are not enough of them, they didn't see things, and people are having things stolen, people are being abused, people are being attacked, people are being killed, and we don't have ways to determine who's guilty. And they said, we're unable to get justice, so we need to use tools like this in order to what? In order to protect the huquq al-ibad. They said, we need to do this because other people in the society have the right to physical inviolability. They have the right to property. And if we can't give them justice when they're attacked physically, or we can't give them justice when something is stolen from them, we have failed to protect their human rights. So that's capital, corporal punishment, and torture in Islamic law. Thank you very much.